I'm Berks County Commissioner Christian Linebach, and I want to welcome everyone to another edition of the Berks County Commissioners Weekly Update. The month of April is National County Government Month, and that is our topic today. We're broadcasting live via Microsoft Teams live event, and also to the Berks Community Television, BCTV, and Facebook and YouTube Live. At this time, I'd like to recognize my executive assistant, Mary Ewer. Mary?
Thank you. Comments or questions must be germane to the topic being discussed and include your full name and municipality where you reside. If you are from the media, please put your name and who you are with. Non-media participants, please limit your questions and comments to one per person.
Thank you very much, Mary. The topic of County Government Month is something that counties have been celebrating since 1991. It's always been the month of April, and the National Association of Counties has really led the effort in helping us share with the public what it is that counties do. Today's program is largely going to focus on the county response and involvement relative to COVID-19. However, we're going to begin our program with some comment and input about a program that NACO has promoted for several years and some new aspects of that program. But before we do that, I want to recognize my colleagues so that they can also make some comments. And we'll start with the vice chair of our board, and that is Commissioner Kevin Barnhart. Kevin?
Good afternoon. Thank you, Commissioner Linebach. Welcome, everyone, especially John Loesch from NACO. I want to thank you, John, for coming forward with the Healthy Program, Live Healthy Program. And I want to thank all of our employees, not just our department heads, for their dedication and willingness to put forth the extra effort in the last 14 or 15 months. And some of these changes that we've experienced are going to become permanent. We haven't completely decided what they will be yet, but definitely it's been a huge learning curve for our county government. And I look forward to the presentations from our leadership here in the county, and turn this back to you, Commissioner Linebach.
Thank you very much, Commissioner Barnhart. Commissioner Michael Rivera, if you'd like to make some comments as well.
Yes, thank you, Commissioner Linebach, and I want to welcome Josh and the rest of our panel here today. Thank you for being here. Looking forward to hearing from our panelists today. And we have different panelists from the county as to what their department has done in reference to COVID, how they operate and so forth. But I just want to be clear that these are not the only departments that have dealt with COVID. Everyone in the county, no matter what department, no matter what you do, has been affected and has been impacted by COVID. So everyone in county government has had a role to play to be able to, one, mitigate COVID, and to be able to continue providing the services that the County of Berks provides. So thank you to the panelists who are on here, but also thank you to all the other department heads and county employees who day after day come to work and do their best to be able to continue providing our services, both if you provide services to the internal staff here or to the public at large. Thank you for what you do. Also want to take a moment to thank Barbara Lopez, who's my executive assistant. Today is National Administrative Professionals Day. So she's a big part of what my office can do. I also want to thank Mary Bureau and Jessica Blauser, who are my colleagues, administrative assistants, as well as Mary Jo and the rest of the team here on the 13th floor. Thank you for all you do to make sure that we can do what we need to do, because you do a lot of the behind the scenes work that you're not seen for. But literally, you know, if you weren't doing that work, we wouldn't be able to do our work. So thank you very much for all you do. Commissioner Linebach, back to you.
Thank you very much, Commissioner Rivera, for showing up, both of your colleagues on broadcast here. We did not recognize our executive assistants. And you know what? I should slap myself for that because I have the best executive assistant Without a doubt. Mary's been here as long as I've been here. And you're absolutely right, Commissioner Rivera. In the same way that no department head acts and is a success in and of themselves, no commissioner is able to do their job. I am not able to do my job without the amazing support that I get every day from my executive assistant, Mary Buer. So well, Commissioner Barnhart,
I just have to add this. Barbara kindly reminded me this morning when I came in that I had forgotten that it was National Administrative Professionals Day, so I was reminded of it this morning.
Okay.
Saved it at the end of the day.
You have to train your assistants. Mine brought me lunch today.
Oh, wow. That could start a whole discussion about people that have been asked to go to lunch with Commissioner Barnhart and who foots the bill.
But well, she knows I'm her assistant.
So, again, we're celebrating National County Month. I don't know about my colleagues, but I know for myself, I really had no idea all the different areas of daily life that counties touch. Even when I ran as a county commissioner, I became amazed what the reality was once I took office. And quite frankly, it's one of the reasons I love county government. It touches so many different areas. We're going to see that on the program today. And again, like my colleague said, we're not saying these are the only departments that have had anything to do with COVID-19. These are just some of the key departments that have played a major role. But before we do that, we're really pleased to have John. And John, I always get mixed up. Is it Losh or Losh?
Pronounced Losh, Commissioner Linebach.
Losh. Okay, good. I always like to pronounce it the way the individual wants it. John's here to tell us about one program that we've been involved in, the discount prescription program, since 2007, and then some new aspects. And in the coming weeks and months, you'll see this promoted here in Berks County. With that, I'll turn it over to John.
Thank you very much, Commissioner Linebach, and also Commissioner Barnhart and Riviera for having me here this afternoon. I'm very excited to join you all as we continue National County Government Month. As Commissioner Linebach said, it is truly an honor to work for the National Association of Counties. I serve as the Associate Membership Director here for NACO, and is really just an honor to serve the true level of government that is doing so much for our communities across the country, and excited to be all here with you this afternoon. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen and talk to you about one of the programs that Berks County is bringing to all of its residents as another way to help save on your health costs. So NACO has had the Live Healthy Prescription Health and Dental Discount Program that first kicked off in 2004. So let's talk a little bit about this program and how county residents can save on your health costs. The pride and joy of the program is, of course, our prescription discount card, which is available at not only within prescriptions within the county, but also at 66,000 participating pharmacies across the country. So as things start to open up and say you go on vacation, you can take your Berks County prescription card on the road with you and save at any one of our participating pharmacies across the country. Now you actually see on the right-hand side of the screen an example of what you will see. These prescription cards will be available at across libraries, across the pharmacy, county buildings, and you can also pick one up at our website, which we'll talk a little bit about here in a moment. And new additions to the program, and the program has been expanded to offer county residents additional discounts on things like health and dental services. These are low fee services that residents can participate in. You can opt into in order to get additional discounts. You can save between 10 to 75% on things like vision services, hearing aids, screenings, diabetic supplies, prepaid lab work, and more. So it's another great way to save on your health services. Say maybe you don't have insurance or you have a high deductible health plan or some other reason to be looking for ways to save on your health program, Live Healthy may have an option for you. And of course, on the dental side, particularly helpful for those who don't have dental insurance or don't have great dental access, you can save between 10 to 15% on dental checkups, cleanings, crownings, x-rays, and more services at over 110,000 participating providers from across the country. We actually, just out of curiosity, did a lookup in preparation for this, and there's over 500 participating dentists just within a 20-mile radius of the county courthouse there. So there's lots of participating dentists that are within our network. So you may be sitting there wondering, how can you get access to these services? Well, of course, as you see the prescription card there on the screen, you can actually go to libraries and pick up a copy of one of these cards, and you may be able to pick up some from county offices and facilities as well. But maybe you're not comfortable going back out yet, and that's why we actually have a fantastic resource on our website. You can visit www.livehealthycard.com, which is shared on the screen in front of you, as well as we also have a phone number if you want to call about prescription discounts, you want to find more about participating pharmacies in your area, you can call the phone number up on your screen, or if you have questions about the health and dental services, the new enhancements to the program we talked about, you can also call and get access to those as well. And of course, you can go to the website and get more information. You can print off a discount card from home. You can actually have a discount card emailed to you, and you can also enroll in the health and dental services. You can look up where participating pharmacies and other providers are, and you can also sign up for those services at livehealthycard.com or by using one of the phone numbers that are up on the screen. And we'll put this up a little bit later if you didn't have a chance to write that down. It's also available on the Live Healthy Card website. So let's dive into some of the ins and outs of these programs and why this is so valuable and being brought to you by the county. Of course, the most common way that residents are saving is using the Live Healthy prescription card. And it's a fantastic way for you to save on your medication and also can help our pets, our furry county residents, save on their prescriptions as well. For those prescriptions that are given to our pets that have a human counterpart, you can actually use your county Live Healthy card in order to save for their prescriptions as well. Now, if you don't have insurance, the prescription card is a fantastic program for you in order to save on your prescriptions. And say maybe you do have insurance, maybe you're underinsured or have a high deductible health care plan and you want to find ways to save, the Live Healthy card is a great way for you to save. On average, you're saving, we can promise about 30% savings, but we've recently reinvested into the actual savings of the program, and Live Healthy participants are actually seeing about a 43% on average savings on their prescriptions. So it is really a fantastic program. And one of the best things about Live Healthy is you don't have to shop around. If your local pharmacy is one of our participatings in our network, you don't have to shop around and go to a bunch of different pharmacies in order to get a good savings on your prescription. You can take your card to the pharmacy and continue to save every time you need a refill. So what has actually looked like it in your community? As Commissioner Linebach said, the county first joined with NACO in 2007. And since the program first began and the county joined, helped save county residents $1.1 million on over 44,000 prescriptions. That's over $1 million that's continuing to stay in the hands of county residents because the county has participated in the Live Healthy program. And the residents have continued to save. Since the beginning of 2020, county residents have saved over $31,000 on the prescriptions, with an average savings about $41 on their prescriptions from within the last year. So really is an incredible way to continue saving on your prescriptions. Now, of course, you may be wondering a little bit more about the health and dental programs as an additional way to get access to savings. And of course, the benefits are is that you don't have any annual limits, you don't have any claims to file, and you also don't have any waiting periods in order to participate in the health or dental program. You can participate in either a low monthly or annual fee for an individual. It's $5.95 for the health or the dental program. Or if you'd like to enroll for your family, which is your entire household, not limited to a certain number of individuals, just your entire household, you can also enroll for about $7.95 a month, or there's also annual fees if you're looking for ways to save on those as well. On the dental side of things, really is a fantastic way to save up to 50% on your things like dental screenings, dental checkups, x-rays, and is really is an incredible program because you don't have to worry about any forms, deductibles, age limits, anything like that. Because you're a county resident, you can participate in this program and sign up at livehealthycard.com and go to one of our participating dentists in order to get access to care. Not only on the health, one thing that I did want to note about our health program, we talked a little bit earlier about some of the services like diabetic supplies, prepaid lab, but we've also reinvested it into the Live Healthy program, particularly important as the time that COVID and the pandemic has broken out. The health program also includes a brand new 24/7 telemedicine service where you can get access to care for your entire family without any additional fees. Once you're participating in the program, you could call and get access to a clinician every 15 minutes, and you don't have to worry about any other deductibles or any other fees. So as so many of us are staying at home, the health program is a fantastic way in order to save just through the telemedicine service alone. Not too long ago, I myself actually needed to access a telemedicine doctor, and through my insurance, it cost me $30 in order to get access to a clinician. That's half of what it would have cost me to sign up for the Live Healthy program, for the health program, for almost a year. So you can call over and over again, continue to get access to these telemedicine doctors, and it's not going to cost you anything once you're already enrolled in the program. So again, how can you get access to the Live Healthy program brought to you by the county? You can visit livehealthycard.com. You can actually see a screenshot of the website here up on the screen. You can print off a card from home, have a card mailed to you, find participating providers, and also have all of your questions answered about Live Healthy. But if there's something that you're still worried about or you want to know more, or maybe you don't have great access to internet, you can also call one of the phone numbers listed on the screen in order to get access to care. So I'll stop there. Again, visit livehealthycard.com or a local library in order to get access to this program. Thank you all again so much for having me here. NACO is excited to partner with the county on the Live Healthy program as we work to build healthier counties for a healthier America. So I'll stop. I just want to know if do we have any questions, comments, concerns before we move on.
John, great job. I just want to let everyone know we have posted the website for livehealthycard.com as well as the phone numbers for dental and health. They're up on Microsoft Teams Live published sector, and they're also being listed on our Facebook page, our YouTube page, and eventually you'll see that a lot of different places. Great information. Two things I wanted to touch on before I open it up to my colleagues. One, maybe you can explain, people think, you know, this is too good to be true. So it probably isn't true. I mean, isn't that that's the normal thinking? It's the way I think. If it's too good to be true, it probably is. But briefly talk about what NACO does to negotiate to get these agreements. These are contracts for a period of time, and every so often those contracts come up. They work to negotiate the agreement, and you have several different players in this right now.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for that question. So, you know, when I first started working with the Live Healthy program, I've been with NACO for about 4 years and have been participating in this program for about the last three. Honestly, I had that same thought. How can this be too good to be true? but NACO has partnered with CVS Caremark, and that's part of the reason why we have such great access to savings and a huge network of pharmacies. Because we've partnered with CVS Caremark, we actually have an opportunity to participate in their network, and we actually get the benefit of all of their contracts and their negotiations. And in the last year, we've been working with them to continue to invest in the program. Actually, within the last year, in addition to all of the enhancements that we've made, we've also increased the average savings that residents are seeing. We used to be only able to promise about 24% savings. Now our contracts are an average of 30%, but we're actually seeing an average of 42% across the country percent savings that residents are seeing. So we have the benefit of a stable network that is continuing to invest and increase the amount of average savings, just because we want to make sure that residents have access to the best savings possible.
And John, it's way beyond CVS. Some people are going to hear CVS and say, so it's only taken at CVS? No, it's far more. Just explain that briefly.
Yeah, absolutely. So CVS is the partner that helps us work on the program, but you can access this at over 66,000 pharmacies across the country. You'll also be able to access this at bigger box chains like Walmarts and Targets and other chain locations, as well as small independent pharmacies also participate in the program as well. So while CVS is the partner, they actually have a network that expands far beyond just the physical CVS location. So there's a lot of opportunities and ways for you to save at pharmacies.
The other comment I have that you might want to explain a little bit, the telemedicine is booming. And as you've noted, it became really big during the pandemic with the inability of people to access their healthcare providers under the in-person circumstances. However, it is free, there's no deductible. We should just clarify that if a prescription's recommended, obviously they're gonna have to pay for that. If there's specific treatment recommended, they'll pay for that. But where the savings is, if they have telemedicine in their insurance, most are requiring some type of copay to access that. And if they don't have it, here it is for a very reasonable cost. But any treatment recommendation ultimately is going to be done at the local level, and there will be a cost involved with that.
Yeah, absolutely. So one of the best benefits of the Live Healthy, it's under the health program where you can get access to the telemedicine service, is that there's no time period that you have to commit in order to participate in the program. So as Commissioner Linebach said, if you need to get access to telemedicine, you could sign up for the program for a month at $5.99 and then get access to the telemedicine service. So it's a really great way. And like you said, if you were most participating insurance programs do have some sort of copay. So it's a really great way for you to get access, mainly just under the copay as well. And like you did said, yes, if you do have prescriptions or other services, that is something you would have to pay for. But really the benefit is that because if you participate in the health discount program, there's no fees or any extra thing in order to get access to a clinician. So if you're traveling, if you are after work hours and you can't get to your doctor, or you're just not comfortable going out to get care, it's a really great way for you to get, for the care to come to you not have to worry about and go out and find care on your own.
Excellent. Any comments or questions from my colleagues? Commissioner Barnhart.
Not at this time, thank you.
Okay.
Nope, but I just want to thank John for the great and valuable information he shared with us. Thank you.
Thank you very much, John. You'll be hearing more from Berks County, and I know Stephanie Weaver, our public relations officer, is already on top of this. The cards are going to be in all of our participating Berks County libraries sometime next week. There'll be posters and other promotions about this program. Thank you very much, John. The next item on our agenda, we're going to go to our Department of Emergency Services. On many levels, our Department of Emergency Services has been involved in the pandemic, actually before it was declared a pandemic. I know myself and my colleagues were in discussions already in February of 2020 with Brian Gottschall, our director of the Department of Emergency Services. People hear from Brian on a weekly basis at our commissioner meetings. He gives the COVID-19 data report in part because he is the lead on our Berks County COVID-19 leadership team. However, today we have the Assistant Director for Emergency Management with us, Matt Sterecker, and Matt is going to talk about the important role that DES has taken throughout the pandemic. Welcome, Matt.
Thank you, Commissioner Leinbach. Let me share my screen quickly here. Sorry about that. Just give me 1 second.
Take your time. Just everybody's looking at you. That's all. Don't worry about
it. All right. Can you see my screen?
All yes. Right.
Good.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay. So just to talk a little bit about the response activities of Berks DES during COVID-19 response, I'm going to start with just a very small amount of background. There was a declaration of disaster emergency that was signed by the commissioners in March of 2020, March 12th of 2020 to be exact. That is what started the process of the county leadership team meetings, as well as opened up purchasing opportunities and waived some of the more difficult parts of the law that can slow down the response to a disaster. At the same time, the same day, the county EOC or Emergency Operations Center was activated. The county EOC is a location where we coordinate government response during a disaster emergency. And this was a little bit different this time around. Normally, our county EOC is an operation where we are all in person in one room, being able to collaborate and discuss the disaster at hand and our response to that disaster. Unfortunately, because of the nature of COVID, we were unable to do that. So we had to use some non-traditional means there, doing a lot of work through Microsoft Teams and by phone in order to make this EOC activation mostly successful so far. During that time, we were doing 12-hour, 7-day-per-week operations that occurred through the middle of March through the middle of April 2020. Then we realized through the experience we had gathered that this was more of a kind of a, I don't want to say a daytime-only emergency, but most of the decisions that needed to happen and the new information came about during kind of a business day. So we transitioned back to 5-day-per-week operations, but there were a lot of, times outside of that obviously people were working on this as well. So some of the things that that the department has done throughout this process, tracking of COVID-19 positivity data. We looked at the data and tried to use that data in order to inform our decisions and to assist the commissioners in informing their decisions in two kind of general groups. First responders, I'll hit first, because that's one of the focuses of our mission at DES. We work with the emergency responders. They're the eyes and ears and the people on the ground getting the job done. And if that population was taken out by this quickly, we would obviously not be able to respond to emergencies. So we were tracking that group very closely. The second is the community as a whole. Obviously, it was important to know the positivity data. It was important to know the hospitalization data, death data, to understand in what direction we were moving within the county. Next, we looked at a PPE needs assessment. PPE is personal protective equipment. Think about things like N95 masks, gowns, gloves, And in this concept, we're even thinking about things like hand sanitizer, which isn't truly PPE, but kind of falls into this category for the purpose of this discussion. We looked at this in kind of two different groups, again, internal county departments, and it says community facing there. And what I mean by community facing is departments that interact with the general public on a regular basis. Folks that weren't able to either work from home or work from the relative safety of the services center or courthouse, but were out interacting with the public on a regular basis. Think of the sheriff's department, corrections folks, probation officers, and that's just to name a few. Obviously, there's many more than that. We looked at the needs of those departments, what exactly they would need to continue to fulfill their critical operations and protect those personnel. We also looked at that from the healthcare and first responder category. Healthcare, for the most part, our large hospital systems were okay. They were able to take care of things mostly on their own. They're large, they have good purchasing power, they can gather resources. Our first responders throughout the county is a very mixed group. We have everything from large municipal police departments to very small volunteer fire companies and small nonprofit ambulance companies throughout the county. A lot of times, one, it was cost ineffective and it was very difficult for them to source PPE to protect their people. And I have firsthand knowledge of this. I actually am with a small ambulance company within the county and know that if we had to completely foot the bill for the entire PPE response to this, we would probably be out of business. But so not only that, but then also just the inability to find PPE in the beginning months of this pandemic was very difficult for first responders. So we looked at that needs assessment, what the needs of those responders were and how we could assist in getting PPE to those folks. Another thing that that kind of came up, not so much from our direction, but from our EMS organizations throughout the county, were coordinated working groups. The EMS organizations, all the EMS chiefs started a regular working group that formed and met daily for the first two or three months and then has slowly scaled back to once a week, but still meets at least weekly. And they were able to do a lot of things like work amongst each other to share PPE that was needed, sometimes even sharing staff when there was a staffing shortage because of issues with infection rates. Our department worked very closely with them. Obviously, we were very involved in the PPE process, which I'll touch on again in a little bit in a minute here, and assisted with their planning. And did whatever we could to help those folks out. That group then expanded out into working groups for police departments and fire departments throughout the county, as it seemed to look like a best practice at that point. And we've had very good success with the police and fire departments. There, it's again PPE sharing, but as well and knowledge sharing amongst those departments. Continuing on, we assess the impact on ongoing community needs, such as food pantry operations, shelters, and community health. This was an area that was incredibly hard hit during the pandemic, especially things like our homeless shelters, our food pantries, our folks that do rental assistance. And these groups also have a kind of public-facing side that we did assist with some PPE needs. But also just try to do things like them for assisting them with access to volunteer staff and helping to coordinate amongst them. We look at community current and future unmet needs assessment. So an unmet needs assessment is a very common process in a disaster. We go through unmet needs assessments in every disaster we do, and we always ask that question of what are the needs we're unable to meet right now and for the foreseeable near future. And that's something that we looked at both on a departmental level and on a county level and on a public safety level throughout this incident. And we're able to use that unmet needs assessment, especially with our PPE planning to really help guide our decisions. internal to our department, a departmental crisis staffing plan. There's three main functional areas to DES. One is emergency management. The second one is hazardous materials emergency response. And the third and biggest area is our 911 communication center. So there's folks in all three of those operations that are critical to the daily life of our citizens. And we needed a way to make sure that we were going to be able to staff our 911 center and that we were going to be able to have lines of succession in our leadership team and ensure that we could continue to fulfill our mission if we lost staff due to infection. We used what's called our continuity of operations plan, or our COOP, to address that. That's a plan that has been set up for years within the county and is relatively common in government and even business sectors to allow for contingency planning for things such as disasters just like this, although this one was a little different than something we've ever really experienced in the past. We assisted county leadership in implementing community outreach and education resources. We worked to assist with the COVID-19 hotline that was hosted here in our office, but with staff from several county departments and guided by county leadership. That hotline was in place for several months, and as the need for it dwindled as we went forward, it slowly has backed off to now where it's an email address that's still available, but the phone side of things is not there anymore. We have the Do Your Part Berks website. This was more of just an assist from our side of things, assisting with providing information, making sure that the most up-to-date information was available for the website. And really, both the website and the hotline were there to connect individuals within the county with any kind of assistance that they needed, as well as to assist with to assist with information regarding the disaster itself and what was happening and what kind of the next steps were. So on to something I know I've talked a whole lot about already, personal protective equipment or PPE. We determined very quickly in this response that our needs for PPE would exceed our available resources. And the interesting thing about this disaster is it's very different than the disasters we've experienced in the past, in that usually a disaster has an outer edge to it. You know, it may affect a city, it may affect a county, it may even affect a state, but there's somewhere on an outer edge that we can reach out to and we can pull in resources from, even if it's as far as a state or two states away. This was totally different for us in that that wasn't there. That kind of made us throw some of the general planning assumptions of emergency management and things that we are very experienced with out the window, and had to figure out how to get something from nothing and do a lot of conservation. One of those things that we did try and do was PPE conservation. So we educated our responders on PPE conservation methods. PPE conservation methods are things like mask reuse, which I'm sure everyone is familiar with, but instead of essentially wearing a mask that was designed for a single use and disposal, people were using masks for up to a week, storing them in different things, from paper bags to hamburger boxes that were purchased specifically for that, just ways to store and keep that PPE as clean as possible for later reuse. Luckily, we're at the place now where that reuse has been scaled way, way back, and where most people are using a mask per shift as opposed to a mask per week. And so we've been able, with the uptick in PPE, to get away from some of that reuse, but it was a very vital part of the beginning of the response. We also looked at non-traditional PPE. One example was when we were having a great deal of difficulty sourcing isolation gowns, we were able to reach out and purchase butcher coats, like the butcher at the grocery store would wear. It's a big, long white coat that goes down past your knees. And we were able to utilize those for to basically supplement our mask supply. They were a reusable item that could be taken off and cleaned and reworn. And again, it's not something people would normally think about wearing in healthcare, but there were times when that was necessary to be used. We worked with county leadership to source PPE to assist first responders and supply county departments. again, that's kind of what I've been talking about a lot throughout the whole time. But one of the ways that that was done outside of just searching for sources and purchasing groups and things like that was non-traditional sources. And one of the examples of those non-traditional sources that was utilized were local distilleries. One in specific, Great Oaks Distillery, stopped distilling the whiskey, which I believe is what they normally distill, and made hand sanitizer. And that happened in a lot of places throughout the county, throughout the state, throughout the country. Where you know they saw a need and they saw a place they could help and turned and helped. Establishing a PPE stockpile in preparation for a possible surge. This was something in the beginning of the pandemic that was very heavily discussed and pressed upon by state and federal government. We really didn't have much of a PPE stockpile. We had PPE, each of our departments had PPE that for this the needs that they normally had. But what we didn't have was a large stockpile for an event like this. And it wasn't a place where we really could reach out, again, because the size of the disaster and you know, what we would normally do through a county emergency management is if we have a disaster, we would reach up and we can't meet the needs of it, we would reach up to the state. State can't meet needs, they would reach up to the Fed. We got some supplies from the Strategic National Stockpile, which is a stockpile of medical countermeasures and PPE and things like that. We got some of those supplies that came down through the state, but by and large, it was not nearly what we needed in order to get this job done. So planning forward as we were able to purchase and find PPE was stockpiling PPE for a possible future surge. And a lot of that was done based upon what our expected call volumes were on a normal day in conjunction with what the current virus levels were and what the projections were. So we do maintain now a small stockpile that should be enough to take care of our first responders and county government and assist some of our healthcare needs and community needs for a short period of time if necessary. And all of our PPE distribution to first responders was need-based. So we used what's called a push model, where we looked at what their normal call volume was or the normal amount of emergency calls they respond to, and utilized that to make a determination as to how much PPE we believe they would likely go through and push that PPE out to them for their use. COVID-19 testing. Is another area where we did a lot of work. We did a lot of coordination with local healthcare providers and retail pharmacies to ensure adequate testing capacity. We worked with folks like Rite Aid and CVS to make sure that they were, or tried to work with them to space their clinics in a way that they were relatively accessible for most people. We also coordinated testing sites with surrounding counties so that Montgomery County and Berks County didn't put a testing site up a mile apart from each other to try and spread that out to service the most amount of people with the least amount of distance and travel and difficulty for them. We assisted with staff with testing site staffing needs, not necessarily by going out and doing it ourselves, but working through our network of volunteers and resources that we have in order to help provide for staffing in some of those locations. We worked with PADOH and PEMA to coordinate pop-up testing clinics. There were two of these operations. The first one was in October of 2020 at First Energy Stadium in Reading. This was very, very well attended. Most of the days that the testing was done, they topped out at the top end of tests they could do. And there were multiple thousands of people that were tested during that pop-up clinic. The second one we did was at Reform Congregation Ohev Shalom in Wyomissing. That was in February of 2021. Not nearly as heavily attended, but it was something that was offered to us by the state and something that we were able to help coordinate the logistics for. And it was still a very worthwhile center that did test hundreds of people over the week it was open. So there's a lot of planning and coordination that went into those two. Another item we did during the pandemic response, it's actually very different from things we've done in the past, is what's called a mid-action review. A common theme in emergency services and emergency response is what's called an after-action review. So after an incident, you do what's called a hot wash or an analysis of what went right, what went wrong, and what we can do better going forward. Because of the way this incident presented as a long, slow incident, as opposed to a rapid incident that lasted, you know, 12, 24, 48 hours, we were able to actually say, okay, here's where we think the middle of this thing is, and we want to do an AAR for the first half, an after action review for the first half. That was in December of 2020. We gathered input through questionnaires and interviews with community partners, like our police, fire, EMS, our nonprofit agencies that work throughout the county, our municipal governments, everyone that we work with on a regular basis. We gathered questionnaires, we interviewed a subset of those folks, and we found out a lot of good stuff. We found a lot of good best practices and lessons learned, and we are using those to apply and have been using those to apply to the remainder of the incident to make sure we're providing the best service we can. There will be an after-action review that will be completed at the conclusion of this full incident. So that should be some very interesting results should come from that. The COVID-19 vaccine, this is kind of where we are now. We're still doing testing. We're still assisting with testing. We're still assisting with PPE. But the main kind of line of our focus right now is on vaccine. And we've been working on this process through coordination with vaccine providers in the county, our health systems, our community health providers like Berks Community Health Center, our local pharmacies, and with PADOH as kind of the overall coordinating entity for all of those. We as the county government cannot directly access vaccine, but we can work through these processes to assist in allocating vaccine to the places where it's most needed. We did further coordination with the state, with state DOH and PEMA, the Pennsylvania Emergency Management Agency, as well as surrounding counties, again, to make sure we're putting things in places that makes convenience for everyone. We assisted elected officials in advocating for vaccine needs of county residents. It's got a decent amount of press, so I'm sure most people are aware of it. The issues that we had with a short vaccine supply in the county, and we did a lot of data analysis to make sure that the commissioners and other folks that were advocating for the county had the best information that they could have to do that advocacy. The Berks Cares Community Vaccine Clinic, this is what we're focused on right now. This is a partnership with Berks County Community Health Center, and this will be a clinic, vaccine clinic, run by Berks Community Health Center, assisted with logistics and staffing by the county, and there's a lot of moving parts to this. We have the staffing piece of it, logistics, acquisition of vaccine, which in and of itself can be challenging, and we're working on a scheduling and reporting software package in order to allow people to go online to schedule a time for their vaccine, and that allow that vaccine information to be properly reported to Pennsylvania, to the State Department of Health. Berks Co-County Wellness is involved in this effort as well as our call center for folks that don't have computer access. I believe that's all I have, and I'll take any questions.
Thank you very much, Matt. I want to note we did have a comment. The individual didn't give their place of residence, so I'm not going to say their name. I responded to it. They wanted to know if, when we talk about warehousing of PPE, is that what was in the farm show? That actually is PPE from the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, has nothing to do with the warehousing locally. We're talking about PPE exclusively for Berks County, for EMS, et cetera, for the Berksheim and the like. Correct, Matt?
Correct.
Yep. Any other questions or comments? Thank you very much, Matt. Appreciate it. We're going to go on to our next presenter, Justin Luce, who is the Chief Information Officer for the County of Berks. And he's going to talk about the technology component in responding to the pandemic. Justin Luce.
Thank you, Commissioner. I think everyone can recognize that this pandemic has really put a lot of strain on IT and technology solutions, mainly to achieve the social distancing and to allow people to work from home. Certainly, you know, our operation was no different. We started 2020 with 2020 slated to be the busiest year kind of on record. We had a lot of major software changes in the county, including a new HR and payroll system, including multiple systems involved in our land records. So we kind of started extremely busy. And very early on, you know, January, February, one thing that Matt didn't mention is that there were a lot of briefings that came from the Department of Emergency Services to the department heads. And anticipating the impact of IT, this really gave us a jump on a lot of those challenges. It allowed us to work with both our chief administrative officer and the purchasing department to get some supplies purchased early on. So we very early at the end of January already started ordering lots of laptops and hardware. And that really fueled our response because a lot of the other organizations that waited to order their hardware, they ran into manufacturing delays and ultimately ended up not being able to get some of that hardware. So that really served us well. So my thanks to the Department of Emergency Services, our Chief Administrative Officer in purchasing for that support. And in addition to like deploying, you know, laptops and hardware, we were really faced with a lot of challenges in public meetings. I know the commissioners were very supportive of having an online presence that would facilitate both wide viewing of the county operations, the different meetings, including these public events that we're doing right now, as well as the opportunity for dialogue and comments. So we were able to push some software early on. We were able to rapidly deploy Microsoft Teams, and we were able to, you know, we were able to get some software in place to facilitate that. The IS team had to pivot and start producing public meetings, which is something that had never been on our radar before. But, you know, huge thanks to my team. A lot of the people are producing these meetings today, and they've done just a fantastic job just in trying to identify technology solutions, rolling with the changes as we've seen, you know, all the manufacturers, including Microsoft, evolve all the features and change all the features that existed in Teams throughout the pandemic. They just did a fantastic job of kind of rolling with the punches and trying to deliver the best solution possible.
I'm just going to add to that. That is so very true. Mary Buer remembers that early in this discussion, we thought it was going to be possible for an executive assistant to produce one of the public meetings. And I talked to Mary after her discussion with someone from IS, and she was like, I just don't get it. And then she talked to another executive assistant, found out the same thing. And the reality is we would not be able to do this without multiple people from IS producing every single one of these programs. And we say this from time to time, but they've done an amazing job. And I know you're the lead, but we've become very used to Heather and Lori and Malcolm. They're kind of the triumphant three that are involved in almost every single meeting. I don't know where we'd be without them. And I don't like to interrupt, but I felt it was appropriate to interject that comment.
No, thank you, Commissioner. And I really appreciate that. And please feel free to interrupt at any time. I also want to really talk about the courts. I mean, the courts have done a fantastic job of really taking some of those same challenges and adopting Microsoft Teams and Polycom and moving a lot of their operations completely virtual. And this has really helped us to keep things moving. It helped us to keep the average daily population down in the jail. And really, they did just a fantastic job of accepting that technology and rolling it out on their own. I mean, certainly we were involved in some of the support, but There was really, they really dug into that technology. Every single one of the judges, every single one of the MDJs was very accepting of the technology, even though in some cases we weren't providing 100% solutions. We were rolling it out rapidly. Sometimes we couldn't give them everything they wanted, and they did a great job of dealing with what they could get and making the best of it. Also, the row officers and the other elected officials, District Attorney John Adams was very supportive of a lot of the technology uses in the courts, even though John himself is, technology isn't always his favorite thing. He's been a very strong supporter of technology along with the other judges. The other row officers really responded well, and each one of them had their own use of technology to facilitate the critical needs of their operation. Particularly, we've seen some very innovative things come out of the Perth Notary's office and the Register of Wills, but really they've all just done a tremendous job, and they've been great partners with us. Overall, just everyone has been very patient with the IS department. Again, it was a huge strain on us. We're not really completely out of the woods yet. Our ticket volumes remain extremely high. We still are deploying new software and new applications as we're not out of the pandemic completely yet. There were a lot of good lessons learned. In summary, I think that 2020 was, had a lot of bad things all the way around. But from a technology perspective, I think there's a lot of things that we can use as lessons learned that are going to provide efficiencies for county operations well into the future. And I want to thank all the commissioners for creating the savings and efficiency team. I think the job of that team originally led by Commissioner Barnhart and now chaired by Commissioner Rivera is really going to help us create both monetary savings and efficiencies for the constituents through the use of technology far into the future. And then, just want to thank everyone for their patience again with IS and the collaboration and support from the other teams. I mean, there's definitely through a lot of those software projects I mentioned that were on deck for 2020, they all still happened. So we had to squeeze them in as well. And that required a lot of work with some of the other county departments, HR, the solicitor's office, purchasing, budget, our chief administrative officer. It's just been great collaboration, and was happy to be of service.
Thank you very much, Justin. And I think you're very right. As awful as the pandemic has been, lives lost, illnesses, not just here, worldwide. One of the positive outcomes is many folks were forced to use technology that they probably otherwise would not have, and have been surprised how effective it can be. Now, I would just tell you this, I found one area where it just cannot replace the experience, and that is conferences. I've gone through a couple now of conferences, and it's tough to replace an in-person workshop with a virtual experience. But overall, this has been an amazing opportunity, and as noted, what you're seeing, if you're watching this program, is going to continue going forward. Even once we are back in person, we will be broadcasting over Microsoft Teams live event or some virtual platform that could change at some point in the future. And in large part, it's because of the experience that we had throughout this pandemic. I don't know if there are any, let me just look here, there is. Okay, that was just a response from the prior individual that had asked a question. So thank you very much. We're gonna go to our next presenter, and we're gonna hear now from Jessica Jones. She is the director of our Area Agency on Aging, really one of the tragedies of the pandemic is when you look at the people that were disproportionately impacted, both at hospitalizations and deaths, overwhelmingly, it was the elderly people in our community. And Jessica Jones and the Area Agency on Aging has really stepped up last year and again this year. And Jessica's gonna discuss the response of the agency relative to the vaccine, the COVID-19 vaccine. Jessica Jones, welcome to the program.
Thank you, Commissioner. Thanks for the opportunity, because I really feel that what we've done as the Area Agency on Aging really is a testament to our staff's commitment on meeting the needs of the elderly population here in Berks County, and ensuring people's safety and well-being also. When we began this back in February, and we were looking at everything, very early on we had identified multiple serious issues around access once the vaccinations became available. And that was really education of individuals. It was also, where do I get my shot? You know, how do I get my shot? Where do I get my shot? I don't have access to a computer. Can't tell you how much we heard that. It was in the newspaper. It was in multiple areas. And so really sitting down with the staff here in our office and talking about how could we begin to help this? How could we begin to identify these needs? We felt that identifying these needs and addressing it met our core mission and our values as an agency. So we poured the resources in that we had to help. The staff fully committed. First, we began, we had begun earlier on with identifying, as we knew the vaccinations were going to begin to roll out, we had identified individuals and have been keeping waiting lists, in essence, of people. Phone numbers, so we could be able to get back in touch with individuals, and also looking at individuals that we currently serve and have in our database, and how were we going to contact these people when the time came. So that was some of our first steps. And then we had several providers come forward. Berks Encore was one of our first providers, and the Hispanic Center. Berks Encore being one of our senior center providers, and the Hispanic Center also being a senior center provider in partnership with Tower Health. So we were able to offer clinics at those centers, which we were able to ultimately vaccinate in those centers within those first several months. Within the first month, we vaccinated close to 1,000 people. So they ended up being very successful. And then as time kind of marched on, early on, we were probably fielding about 200 calls a day, I would say, that were coming in, and we were getting calls from people, trying to keep up with the volume, trying to call people back, staff volunteering at clinics once the clinics had opened and we were able to reach people. But a testament to what the staff had done here, overall, we had assisted over 800 individuals, older adults or their caregivers, individuals that fit in that 1A category initially, with accessing and scheduling the vaccinations. What we did, we helped with how do we get them onto these links, how do we do, you know, creating spreadsheets, helping with the providers. There was lots of things that were going on behind the scenes. More recently, our calls have decreased, which is a good thing. I'm hoping that's showing that we're seeing more and more individuals are receiving the vaccination, but now we've kind of moved forward with certain things because they've changed. The governor signed an order back in mid-March where he had identified providers as local pharmacies that were getting the vaccinations to work with the area agencies on aging. So that opened up another door for us, which allowed us to then assist people with scheduling. We had, at one point in time, we had 5 full-time staff assisting with scheduling on a routine daily basis. once now, as I said, our call volume is going down and we were able to work through our waiting lists. We were able to work through all of our consumer, our current active people that we knew were receiving aging services, be it out of a senior center, be it in-home services. Once we were able to work through those pieces, now we're kind of moving to another piece where we're addressing the homebound issue. We are currently working, it was just in the paper this last week, we are currently working in partnership with Berks Community Health Center. We are screening individuals, identifying those individuals that are homebound that need a vaccination, and then working with Berks Community Health Center to actually have someone go out and do the vaccinations for these people. So overall, I want to just be really brief, Commissioner. I can't tell you enough how much our staff have really committed here in the county to making sure that we were meeting the needs of the consumers and even the provider base that we have here in Berks County, between the senior centers, the home care agencies, a lot of our other contractors. It definitely was a huge team effort.
There's no doubt in my mind, Jessica, that especially our executive assistants, early on, back in February, we were getting calls left and right, overwhelmingly from older folks, and the area agency in aging was a huge help. Knowing that we were able to forward these calls, a lot of times connect them directly to someone in your office, and that they received the help and the direction, makes such a difference. And it makes the job a little bit easier for the executive assistants. So we're taking some very frustrated phone calls. People, there was an anticipation, the vaccine's here, I want it, why can't I get it? Absolutely. And you and your team did a great job in helping many of our older residents.
And one last point, Commissioner, definitely if individuals are coming across homebound, what they feel are homebound individuals that can't get out and become and get vaccinated, they should call our office. Call the main number, 610-478-6500. And we'll have them speak to a staff person, we'll screen the call, we'll talk them through process. We're continuing to kind of gather names and we're continuing to try to serve those individuals.
Thank you very much. And sure, we will post that contact number up on Microsoft Teams live event as well as Facebook and YouTube shortly so people can call. And you're especially interested in those individuals that are homebound. They can't use paratransit, they can't get out, and the area agency and aging along with the Berks Community Health Center is helping folks that are in that particular challenge, right?
Absolutely, yep.
Thank you very much, and be sure to thank your team for their great work. We appreciate all that they're doing.
Thanks, Commissioner.
Now we're going to go to our last presenter, Allison Troutman. Allison is the Outreach Services Coordinator for the Berks County Library System. And boy, 2020 did not end up at all like you anticipated as an Outreach Coordinator at the beginning of the year. What you ended up doing for Outreach and continue to do is very different. Allison, thank you for joining us for National County Government Month. And tell us a little bit about the library system and how you've been dealing with the pandemic, how it's impacted a lot of our local libraries in the library system, and then talk to us about the mobile job lab. Allison.
Sure, thanks so much for having me. So essentially in March, all of our libraries were closed due to an order from the State Library of Pennsylvania. And while we were shut down, we realized that there was just no computer or internet access for many people who rely on libraries for their internet access and connection. We still had Wi-Fi available in our parking lots, but it's really just not the same as being able to use a real computer, especially if you don't have your own device, which is frequently why people are visiting the library. And then if you need to print something out, obviously we didn't have any printers that you could use either. So right now you need the internet to do everything, apply for jobs, unemployment especially, paying bills, staying in contact with loved ones, especially during this pandemic. But in March, we also saw those unemployment numbers rising. And I knew that people were going to need help job searching if their jobs didn't return. And naturally, libraries are a place where people frequently turn when they do need job searching help. So to help with this, I came up with the idea for a mobile job lab and wrote a grant on behalf of the Friends of Berks County Public Libraries to the Berks County Community Foundation. And I requested the funds, and they generously provided those funds for me out of the Holly and Myrtle Choir Fund. And so early on in the process, we worked with the Workforce Development Board of Berks County, and they then put us in touch with CareerLink, who has also been a very valuable partner in this, to give us assistance in job searching resources. So the mobile job lab, what is it? When a lot of people hear that, they think that I'm driving a van out around Berks County. No, it's just me and my car and some laptops, but it's 3 to 8 laptops that people can use. You can create cover letters, you can search for jobs, you can polish your resume. Basically, I set up as many laptops as the space allows and ensures social distancing. Anyone who uses the lab needs to wear a mask and have your temperature checked. You have to answer 2 health screening questions just to make sure everyone's being kept safe. We also have a printer that you can use to print copies of your resume, and just anything else you might need when searching for a job. I'll help you run interview questions. And we also have someone from CareerLink who assists as well. And they can fill in any gaps, anything I don't know, they definitely know. So we're here for you to help in whatever way that we can. So we had some really great feedback from some of the people who have used the mobile job lab so far. So one day I was talking with a woman who is looking to change careers after 40 years, and she just didn't have any resume set up. So for about 2 hours, I sat there with her and we created a resume together. So she's ready to start her job search. She didn't have a computer at home, but we were so happy that we were able to be there for her. And if you can see on the screen, we have pictures from one of our visits. So we've been to about 4 locations so far, and we have 3 more planned. We were at the Zion Lutheran Church in Shoemakersville in November, and you can see that it's laptops and tables and chairs, which is really fantastic. Yes, we love the mobile job lab. But basically, if you're looking to transition from one job to another, if it's your very first time applying for a job, I spoke with someone who was preparing for her very first interview, and she wanted to be ready for it. So she came to the mobile job lab and I ran practice questions with her, and we sat there together and I helped her. She emailed me later and said that she thought she made a really good impression on her interviewer, and she thanked me for my help, which was probably the best compliment I've ever received. So we have more stops planned, which is really fantastic, but this next round of stops, we're also going to be offering a resume class courtesy of the CareerLink. And yes, so we have lots of fun things planned that will hopefully help anyone who is looking to transition jobs, to have to get a new job, to, change jobs. Your job searching needs, we are here for them.
Thank you very much. That brings us to the end of our agenda of presentations. No, actually it doesn't. Did I skip over one? I'm looking here, facilities department. There it is, one more. I'm trying to race ahead here. Fortunately, I see here item number 6. The last area we're going to look at is our facilities and operations department. Obviously, this is another area of county government where what was anticipated at the beginning of the year became dramatically impacted and very different as a result of the pandemic, not the least of which over $5 million worth of capital projects were put on hold roughly in April of 2020 by the commissioners in order to save money. Today we have Matt Sulkowski with us. He is the Director of Facilities and Operations, and he's going to talk a little bit about the actions that his department had to take to address the pandemic. Matt.
Thank you, Commissioner Linebach, and thank you for everybody tuning in today. As Commissioner Linebach stated, the Facilities Department in February of 2020 sort of took a turn, a transition from projects to focusing on keeping staff and county visitors safe when coming into county facilities. So with the communication that we received from DES as well as the commissioners in late February of 2020 and beginning of March of 2020, we began procuring PPE, cleaning supplies, electrostatic sprayers, and began to look at social distancing and other operations to be able to continue county operations but keep them safe. So during that time, we worked with our local supplier, Veritiv. We secured electrostatic sprayers for cleaning of county facilities, county vehicles, focused on getting hand sanitizer, cleaning supplies, which then we disseminated to our departments to be able to, for them to focus on cleaning of their particular areas. During that time, we also took a turn from a focus with some of the staff into their focus during their daily activities of cleaning high touch points throughout the facilities, the Ag Center, the courthouse, and the services center, going around elevator buttons, doorknobs, bathroom handles, and that was their primary focus, and it continues to be their primary focus to continue to keep the county safe. After we got through part of the beginning of the year, of March through June, then we started focusing on our plexiglass in regards to, I met with multiple department heads throughout the county to discuss needs for plexiglass to keep the employees safe as well as patrons that would come into the county safe as well when they were visiting particular offices. We were looking at long-term and short-term solutions as well as being fiscally responsible during those studies. To update everybody, we have all of our plexiglass installed throughout the county in our courtrooms, in our jails, and in our departments. So that was a great project that we all took on and worked together with everybody throughout the county. Also with the electrostatic sprayers, we put a weekly cleaning program in place out at the Ag Center for cleaning of county vehicles. So it's sort of like a little bit of a drive-through car wash. We come in, vehicles come in, we disinfect them, and then they sit for a couple minutes and then they can move on. During this process, we also coordinated with the commissioners as well as Ron Seaman, our chief administrative officer, in the install of thermal readers at the entrances of the courthouse and the services center, which are installed and updated and working and functioning. The main key thing during this time was education of the janitorial and custodial staff. To keep them updated on CDC guidelines and CDC recommendations on cleaning procedures as we work through the pandemic. And I can't thank enough the custodial staff and the facility staff that basically had to turn on a dime and focus from projects and preventative maintenance to janitorial work to keep the county buildings clean and safe for everybody coming in. Also during this time, we worked with our HVAC companies and technicians. We were currently using MERV 13 filters in all of our air handlers, but we increased the frequency of the filter changes and also worked on introducing additional outside air into all the facilities inside the county to keep the air exchange moving so it can continue to replenish with fresh air. In the process too, we are installing touchless faucets throughout county facilities in the Ag Center, the Courthouse, the Services Center, and the BCRC. And like Commissioner Linebach said, COVID tremendously impacted the capital plan and procurement throughout 2020 and continues into 2021 of working to get projects done contractors were put on pause, and but we're moving in the right direction. A lot of our capital projects are coming to fruition in 2021, and we should be able to get them completed this year. So that's the facilities update on COVID.
Thank you very much, Matt. Again, appreciate all the work that you've done, especially last year as we began to come back in the building after a lot of the furloughs. You and your team had to really respond quickly to provide plexiglass separation. You were involved heavily in the election. A lot of different areas, and we appreciate the work that you and your team, and we recognize again it is a team. There are no additional questions on the comments as far as I can see. Are there any comments or questions from my colleagues? Hearing none, I'd like, before we go, to note that next week, April the 28th, we will be having a municipal primary election preview, and it really isn't just a preview of the election. Ron Rutkowski and his team will be going over some of the recommendations that we received both internally and externally as a result of the 2020 election, and the areas that we're able to implement that make sense, we will be addressing those on this meeting. So I encourage you to tune in on Wednesday, April the 28th at 3:30 p.m. And hopefully it will prepare you for what to expect in the municipal election. Thank you for joining us for another weekly program, and we look forward to seeing you next week. Thank you.